Elmer Henke's theory of civilization is indeed provoking and brave endeavor to explore the domain usually neglected by conventional sociology. In general, modern social sciences are expected to follow certain procedures of research, like collecting empirical evidence, discovering cause-effect relations, making the predictions, etc. A formal scientific method tends to compartmentalize human experience into specific categories, like strictly biological or mechanical ones, preferably measurable by quantitative indices. According to mainstream thinking, every more general attempt to understand human existence must be qualified as metaphysical or even speculative, which is not quite true. I am very interested in the problem of rationality and objectivity within social sciences. And the problem really exists, as in case of efforts to justify hierarchies within contemporary society and to introduce the concept of homo hierarchicus by Francis Fukuyama. My philosophical and social study on this topic was quite revealing for me. I presume that rationality, despite highly intellectual vocabulary, can be disclosed as biased ideological assumption. According to Elmer Henke's theory of civilization, existential insecurity of human beings has induced them to create protective spheres of symbols, which are myths, religions, values, belief systems, theories, etc. Rationality is one of the key factors contributing to the construction of civilization in technical and symbolic terms. As Henkisch has emphasized, protective spheres of symbols may collapse, thus causing a profound social crisis. For example, there were tremendous social and political transformations at the end of the 20th century. As a result, management theories have been revised to deal with transition and uncertainty. Francis Fukuyama has reacted to the dispute by the book The Great Disruption. His approach has been supportive of hierarchical organization as the best solution when facing a disruption. Due to the lack of time, I will focus on a couple of Fukuyama's arguments, historical and biological, just to trace the inconsistencies. Fukuyama's approach is some sort of response to the rising civil society and new ideas regarding a reconfiguration of organizational framework to replace hierarchical structures by spontaneous networks having higher degree of freedom. He appeals for the rational normative values which supposedly are in favor of existing hierarchies. But the definition of rational norms indicates what is wrong with rationality itself. Allegedly, these norms are chosen after rational choice and rational discussion. The only discrepancy in this definition is namely, who sets the terms of discussion? Fukuyama has referred to so-called neutral and historically proven authority, Protestantism, thus frequently quoting Max Weber. Fukuyama's chosen examples of failed societies mainly point to non-Protestant regions as Latin America or Southern Italy. So Homo hierarchicus is a very interesting entity which manages to purify all irrational drives in its way to higher efficiency. Fukuyama is not convincing in this regard because there are many authors like Richard Toney or Fernand Braudel who indicated more complex patterns of capitalist society's development. Richard Toney has made a very relevant remark in his book Religion and the Rise of Capitalism. In every human soul, there is a socialist and an individualist, an authoritarian and a fanatic for liberty, and in each there is a Catholic and a Protestant. It seems that Fukuyama's rational values are rather affirmative than normative. Another biological Fukuyama's argument for hierarchy is worth quoting. It's a long quotation, but it's quite interesting. The beginning of quote. There is a final reason why hierarchy is not about to disappear from modern organization anytime soon. Human beings by nature like to organize themselves hierarchically. Or to put it more precisely, those on the top of hierarchies find the satisfaction that recognition of their social status brings so enjoyable, that it frequently outweighs money and material wealth as a source of happiness. Those on the bottom of hierarchies like it much less. But we usually have no choice. In any case, there are enough hierarchies scattered about in modern societies that most people can end up in the middle to upper range of at least one of them. Either way, what people dislike most is not hierarchy in principle, but hierarchies in which they end up in the bottom. End of quote. So if you want to be happy, just fit the right hierarchy. Fukuyama has invoked here two biological chemical claims. Firstly, the feeling of happiness depends on the level of serotonin within brains, and the second, the dominance in hierarchy increases the level of serotonin in the brain of chimpanzee males in their fights for alpha male status, according to some biological researchers. Why chimpanzees? Naturally, they frequently confess before human beings for explanatory purpose. The cause-effect reasoning can hide certain flaws of subjective and manipulative character, what is supposed to draw a close attention to the issue of hierarchical happiness, or in other words, the myth of serotonin. Serotonin as a chemical compound within human brains is widely expected to be a physical substance of happiness or good psychological well-being. The shortage of serotonin and depression is the causal link admitted in psychiatric practice. Antidepressant pharmaceuticals are supposed to increase the level of serotonin and to cure depression. But there is a troubling statistic. According to the US National Health and Nutrition Examination Service, antidepressants were the third most common prescription drug taken by Americans of all ages and the most frequently used by persons aged 18-44. There is indicated nearly 400% increase of antidepressant use in the United States among all ages. So we may conclude that the problem of happiness is quite a complex one and includes more than hierarchical fitness. The progress itself and the presence of abundant hierarchies did not diminish human anxiety and fear. Following Elmer Henkisch, much that allegedly is improved only may be a more sophisticated technique to repress disturbing human experiences. A hierarchy being available as such nevertheless is not a natural or social necessity. Homo hierarchicus, like its cousin Homo economicus, is just another symbolic bubble imposing certain dominant values. This may sound trivial, but as pointed out by Elmer Henkisch, trivialities are sometimes not trivial at all. Thank you.